Hi, my name is Adwoa, and in this video, we're going to cover the kinds of controls you need to consider when doing your assay. These controls are in relation to multi-well assays such as ELISAs and other plate-based assays, but the principles may apply in other instances. Now, when you're doing an assay, you want to have a sense of the data that you collect relating to the biology that you're studying and not related to the instrument or the equipment or the assay that you're doing, the technique itself. And so there's this idea of normalization. And in the ELISA setting, you need a blank well. These blank wells allow you to subtract information that is irrelevant to the actual assay that you're studying. So information that is due to the buffer that you're using to do the enzyme reactions in. In other words, your blank measures the background values, and the blanks are how they're handled is that they are averaged and then subtracted from each value, each well on the microplate, so that you can subtract out information that is irrelevant to the study, the target, the biology. A necessary control is a negative control. Negative controls allow you to confirm scenarios where you do not expect a result. And in that case, it confirms that your setup is working. So it involves you either omitting the antibody that you're using to capture the particular target or analyte. Or you may omit the actual sample. So the sample is not there, doesn't contain the analyte, so there's nothing to give a result. Or you may just omit the standard. Now, this negative control when you are doing a sandwich ELISA, yes, it's a negative control, but when you're doing a competitive ELISA, keep in mind that it's going to be called a non-specific binding well. So they may designate it as an NSB well or NSA, non-specific activity well. In this well, you're omitting the antibody, and so you don't really expect a result. And if you do get a result, then you know something went wrong in your assay. In the vein of a negative controls, there is a B naught designation that you may encounter, and this is in specifically in competitive ELISAs. The B naught is a specific denomination of the zero standard. So you would have standards on your plate ranging from high to low or low to high that you've serially diluted. And the B naught will refer to that well where you did not actually include any of the standard. Its equivalent in a sandwich ELISA is the S naught. They're given different designations on a sandwich ELISA versus a competitive ELISA because in a competitive ELISA, because there is no standard or sample analyte, it will be the well that leads to maximum color development. On a sandwich ELISA, when you don't have a standard or sample analyte in the S naught, you will actually have the least color development. So that's why it really has the different designations. So in a competitive ELISA, it's B naught, you don't have a standard in that well, and so you get the maximum color development owing to the fact that the conjugated analyte does not phase binding competition, and so maximal conjugate binding is achieved. The B naught in this way communicate the maximum color development in the competitive ELISA and is used to control for full functionality of all assay components. It is expected that it could generate results that are above the maximum detection range of the assay. How you handle this particular value is that the B naught value is used to reference the relative binding in a sample or standard to the maximum possible binding, and it's used to analyze the assay readout. The ratio that result is commonly referred to as percentage of binding, percent binding, or B over B naught, and is therefore recommended to include B naught controls in every assay in every competitive ELISA. Again, in competitive ELISA, this is your 100% bound analyte as opposed to competitor, because there's no competitor in the system.
In contrast, the NSB, which is the S naught in a competitive ELISA, is your 0% binding. So that's it for negative controls. You also want to include a positive control. Now, positive controls confirm that the assay is working as it should or as expected. And so when you're trying to measure a particular analyte, you will find a situation where you know the analyte is present and use that in a couple of the wells so that you can track that the response is as expected. Now, standards are not typically thought of as a positive control, but you have known quantities of the analyte that you add to the buffer in a standard. And so it's probably the purest form of a positive control. So standards, while they are their own particular category in your assay, could be looked at like a positive control in that you've got known quantities of the analyte that you've added to the assay, and if the response is as it should be in terms of the dilutions that you've performed, that gives you an indication that the setup is working also. But it is commonplace to also include a positive control well. I'm going to mention that in a competitive ELISA, you would also have a total activity well. And so this total activity well is actually controlling and allowing to ensure that you have enzyme activity throughout the length of the incubation. So the total activity serves to ensure enzymatic activity of the enzyme-conjugated antibody biochain or analyte. In this well, only the substrate and enzyme conjugate are incubated together during the assay's development. They are used to monitor the enzyme activity over a long assay incubation procedure, for instance. So if you know that in that well, the enzyme and its substrate are reacting and doing as they should over a long period of time, then your responses can be validated in that way, so you know that it's a genuine response and not maybe due to the substrate and its enzyme conjugate decaying over time. You're probably familiar with the format of these sorts of micro well assays. If not, I do have a previous video here that goes through a regular sandwich ELISA. And so in here, I'll talk more about like a competitive ELISA where the analyte is in your sample or in your standard, and then the analyte is incubated with the analyte specific antibody. It's allowed to react for a given amount of time, an hour or so, or even overnight at 4 degrees Celsius. Then the analyte that is coupled to an enzyme, being a competitive ELISA, is then introduced to the sample so that it competes for antibody where antibody has not bound. Well, we say compete, but it just essentially also goes to bind to the antibody, and where there was an analyte in the sample, it's already bound to the antibody, so it has no opportunity to bind. And the analyte coupled to the enzyme allows you to visualize the assay. And so your plate layout would look something like this, where you have your standards ranging from high to low, and then you have control wells, and the control wells will give you a sense of what's happening, that things are progressing as it should.